I want to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Gerald McDermott for spending the week with us in conversation. When I ask in BE 101 how many of you have ever heard of the topic of typology, that number is becoming less and less, which reflects a lot of what he has been saying has happened in the church at large. And so this is a stretching week. As I have interacted with him and with some of you, questions like, what is the definition of a type? And how do we know? Is there a difference between types and illustrations? Is there a divine intent versus a human recognition, or is the answer yes? Is it the appreciative recognition of available analogies that God has built into nature that we recognize, or is there an intended meaning in those analogies that all mature people should be answering the same way? Is there differences of signification or meanings assigned by different preachers? And are those option to multiple meanings and multiple layers, or are they more singular? Do types establish doctrine, or do they just illustrate doctrine? Many typologists have tried to establish new doctrines by their typology. What's the significance to the language of the New Testament when it uses typographical language that finds itself uniquely Christological? And how does that relate to the wider phases? Those are questions that we talk about. Those are questions that we've had in the hallways and even in the faculty discussions that we had with him. Some of those are addressed in his lectures. Maybe some of those will also be in the book that he's writing about it that we wait to read. But Jerry, thank you for spending this week. You have stretched us, your knowledge of church history, your diligent scholarship over the years is a model to us and a challenge to us. And you have made us think and ask questions afresh, and we have gained insight and appreciation for the greatness of our God. So would you join me in welcoming Dr. Gerald McDermott back to our platform today? Thank you.
Well, thank you, President Bailey. Thank all you for hanging in there this week. You are going to be stretched some more this morning, perhaps more than the other three. But I just want to say, you know, just to pick up on what President Bailey just said, types, that is, an orthodox understanding of typology is that types never establish doctrines. Types only illustrate doctrines. And so that is a very important distinction. Yeah. I just want to say that I've really enjoyed my week here at DTS. I've been very impressed by people I've met from all over the world. You know, there's a lot of faithful students here from all over the world, full of courage, because I know a lot of you, as you go back to where you are, it's not always safe to proclaim Jesus of Nazareth as the Lord of the cosmos and the only way to the Father. Those are explosive words these days on this planet. And I admire you, and I admire DTS, and I'm full of gratitude for the enormous impact that DTS is having on this world in this critical stage in what Jonathan Edwards called the history of redemption. That is ongoing. And actually, that's what we're going to talk about today, types in history. When Paul was in Athens talking to Greek philosophers, he said that one of their poets got it right when he wrote, "In him we live and move and have our being." Now, in other words, not only is God in history, as every Christian can and indeed must say, but history is in God. Nothing, therefore, is outside God, as if anything could happen without his holding it in existence nanosecond by nanosecond. After all, Paul wrote elsewhere that in Messiah, and of course, I like to remind people over and over again that that's what Christ means, and it would be really healthy theologically from the pulpit to practice replacing the word Christ with Messiah, and Christian with messianic, and Christianity with the messianic community. In Messiah, all things hold together. Synesteken. Therefore, not only is popular deism, the idea that history proceeds without God's intervention, absolutely absurd for a biblical Christian, but even the most common Christian, not most common, but even the fairly common Christian conception that God moves major actors in history with everything else thereafter pulled along, this too falls far short of Paul's claim. Types in history, then, and that's where we're moving to today. We're not talking about nature anymore. We're talking about history, a whole different way of thinking. Types in history, then, are the patterns we can recognize in the midst of mostly unrecognizable ways in which everything is in God and mysteriously directed by Him, if not directly by impulse, then indirectly by permission. That's the first thing that has to be said about types in history. They are recognizable patterns in human affairs that point toward their Trinitarian author. And they are there by divine direction for that purpose, among others. Scripture tells us that God made known His acts to His people Israel, but His ways to Moses. Moses apparently learned God's ways through the patterns or types revealed in his acts, informed by his words. The second thing that should be added about history in general, before we consider types more specifically in history, is that history is at once directed and fragile. By fragile, I mean that nothing in history per se determines inexorably its future direction. It could go in any one of a variety of ways. In other words, God's in control of history, but He does that through voluntary human choices. So there's that mysterious paradox of God's sovereignty and human freedom operating in history. So looking at it from the human side of human freedom, history could go in any one of a variety of ways with long-term consequences for the whole world. The great Cambridge University historian Herbert Butterfield wrote in his magisterial Christianity and History, and if you deal with church history, if you deal with history at all, that's a must-read classic. It was published in 1949. And he wrote in there of the unspeakable liquidity of history. And here's a mind-numbing quote. Indeed, if Mr. Churchill had been ill or had lost heart in 1940, the mind must reel before the multitude of alternative courses that the world might have taken. Hitler might have won. We would all be speaking German, and I would be afraid of saying something that might offend our new Führer. So while we will see that history is full of types that point toward the end of history, their presence does not mean we can predict the intermediate future. Christ will win in the end, we know that. And the types point to that eventual victory, but our Lord has not told us of the twists and turns that will take place before the end. But He has told us, according to Jonathan Edwards, some of the patterns in those twists and turns, and those patterns are types. One of the most significant is the pattern of revivals directing the biggest twists and turns. Religious revivals and reformations are the engine of the historical drama, driving its sudden turns and, to some degree, its later twists. Now, Edwards points to major junctures in Israel's history as examples of this pattern or type. Covenant renewals, for example, under David, Hezekiah, and Josiah, were religious revivals that forever changed the history of redemption. The rise of the church, the Christian church, Christianity, in the first century was an enormous revival that eventually conquered the Roman Empire. and change the course of history. Constantine's conversion, that conquest of the Roman Empire, was the leading edge of another revival in the 4th century that shaped medieval Europe. The Reformation was still another revival, and it was the principal historical movement that gave shape to modern Europe. We can then use this Edwardsian approach to history to argue with some historians that the Great Awakening of the 18th century was an American revival that helped precipitate the American Revolution, apart from which there would not have been an American Revolution. Most historians in my field would today agree with that. Many historians would also agree that the American Civil War would not have occurred without the revival of the Second Great Awakening and the abolitionist movement that the Second Great Awakening spawned. Hence, the last two millennia bear witness to what can be called the historical type of revival producing revolutions of all sorts. This is a historical type pointing back to a biblical pattern of God's ways with his human creatures. Now, I've been declaring that these are types in history without actually arguing for the validity of such a phenomenon. So I'll now try to make my declaration, my claim, a little bit more plausible by discussing the National Covenant. This is a long tradition going back to the early church. Now, how many of you have heard of the National Covenant? A few of you. It goes back to the early church and the whole Bible, I would argue, that teaches that God deals with whole societies, not just individuals. Although most Christians have believed this for most of the last 2,000 years, and it's hard to deny if you pay serious attention to the Bible, it's been a minority view since the Enlightenment, and especially in this last century. Theologians, particularly since the 1960s, have tended to regard the idea that God deals with whole societies and whole nations as presumptuous and inevitably leading to idolatry of the nation. This way of thinking was heightened after the Vietnam War, which most intellectuals thought was a terrible mistake. They wondered where the idea came from that saw the United States as a redeemer nation whose mission it was to bring its political salvation, the American form of democracy, to the rest of the world. And you had the same kind of debate after the war in Iraq, after the invasion in Iraq, and then the chaos in Iraq that then ensued. Historians and theologians laid the blame at the feet of the Puritans, who came to the New World on what Perry Miller called an errand into the wilderness. They came, he argued, for the purpose of reforming England and then the world by being a city on a hill whose light would shine far and wide, transforming those who beheld its glory. Now, is it true that God deals with whole societies? Well, he certainly dealt with the nation of Israel as a whole, promising rewards for its obedience to the covenant and punishments for unfaithfulness to the covenant. In Leviticus 26 and Deuteronomy 28, we particularly see this. Now, Edwards argued that God deals with other societies as well. He quoted Proverbs 14:34. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Look, he preached, at how God treated the whole world in Noah's day as a society that deserved punishment by a flood. Look at Sodom and Gomorrah, destroyed for their wickedness. Look at Egypt, that was punished by the plagues. Look at Canaan, whose tribes were defeated and then ousted because of their egregious sins. Now, Edwards told his congregation, which was the largest outside of Boston, in an 18th century megachurch of 1,000 souls, that in droughts and plagues and earthquakes, God was chastising New England for its failures to live up to its national covenant. Now, according to this tradition, the national covenant had to do with this life only, not the next, which was administered according to the covenant of grace. God is more strict in punishing a wicked nation in this world than a wicked person. After all, it's clear that wicked persons often prosper in this world. But nations as nations are punished only in this world. Often God endures their wickedness for a long time. But it's a biblical pattern, he insisted, that when wickedness becomes open and unashamed and pervasive, and when that nation's leadership endorses and defends perversity, then that nation is close to destruction. Now, Edwards said God first warns the nation of impending doom in a variety of ways. One way is to permit other nations to threaten it with an attack of some kind. Now, Edwards said this happened when various nations arrayed themselves against Judah in the first century before Rome finally destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD. Now, another way that God warns is to bring lesser judgments before a great judgment. And according to Edwards, this is what happened when Pharaoh was warned of his coming doom by the 10 plagues. A third warning is judgment on a neighbor, such as when captivity of the 10 northern tribes in 721 BC was a warning to the southern tribes, who were captured a little more than a century later. Fourth, God sends sometimes messengers to warn, as he sent Noah and Jonah and other prophets. A fifth kind of warning is when God sends a revival, such as the revivals under Josiah and Hezekiah before final destruction in 586 BC. And other revivals as warnings came under Jonah to Nineveh, and then under Jesus and the apostles before the fall of the city. First the fall of Nineveh, and then the fall of Jerusalem, just decades after the warnings came, after the revival came as a warning. Note the counterintuitive motif, revivals as a sign of looming judgment. Revivals can actually increase a nation's guilt if they don't bring repentance and reformation. All of these patterns are historical types. That is, they are words in events sent by God to point to future events in biblical and post-biblical history. Now, we've heard from Edwards on historical types, but have more recent theologians seen types in history? The short answer is that even during the last century, there's been a minority of theologians and philosophers who have argued that God's providence can be seen in a society and in ways that undermine natural national self-righteousness. In other words, you can believe in a national covenant in ways that don't lead to a sense of self-righteousness, but quite the opposite. The late Robert Bella, for instance, asked, what Christians call the Old Testament is precisely, or he said, he didn't ask, what Christians call the Old Testament is precisely the religious interpretation of the history of Israel. Now, is it so clear that American analogizing from the Old or New Testament is necessarily religiously illegitimate? Why should the history of a people living 2,000 or 3,000 years ago be religiously meaningful, but the history of a people living in the last 200 or 300 years be religiously meaningless? Now, philosopher Leroy Rooner argues similarly that America has historical significance and suggests that this fact is largely lost at present because the left has fallen out of love with its homeland and the right has celebrated it for mostly wrong reasons. The great Lutheran theologian Wolfhart Pannenberg, I told you yesterday, greatest Lutheran theologian of the 20th century, thought that the notion of national covenant had often accurately described the fortunes of a people relative to other peoples. Quote, it would be unfair to belittle the obvious element of truth in this sense of historical destiny. The English Revolution, for example, did indeed pioneer the political emancipation in the Western world. Now, Pannenberg added that the idea of a national covenant has explanatory power. The destruction of Germany in World War II, he said, may have been a judgment on Germany's persecution and attempted annihilation of the Jewish people. H. Richard Niebuhr interpreted historical contingencies from a similar perspective. H. Richard Niebuhr was probably the most noted Reformed theologian of the 20th century. His brother was Reinhold Niebuhr, of course, who really was not a theologian. He was much more of an ethicist, and Richard was the real theologian. So Richard suggested that the rise of Marxism in the 30s was a judgment on the injustices and class interests of Christian communities. And he interpreted the dust storms on the American prairies of the 1930s as signs of judgment on man's sinful exploitation of the soil. Now, Niebuhr's explanation of these interpretations by his doctrine of responsibility was remarkably analogous to Edwards's doctrines of divine sovereignty and national covenant. In all actions impinging on the self, Niebuhr said, God is acting. The responsible self must therefore respond to all actions so as to respond to God's action. And the same interpretation must be given to the events happening to a whole society. Now here's a long quote that I think I put in your notes. At the critical junctions in the history of Israel and of the early Christian community, the decisive question men raised was not what is the goal, nor yet what is the law, but what is happening? And then, what is the fitting response to what is happening? When an Isaiah counsels his people, he doesn't remind them of the law they're required to obey, nor yet of the goal toward which they are directed, but calls their attention to the intentions of God present in hiddenness in the actions of Israel's enemies. The question he and his peers raise in every critical moment is about the interpretation of what is going on, whether what is happening is a drought or the invasion of a foreign army or the fall of a great empire. Now, Pottenberg said that this idea of a national covenant, which sees types in history pointing to God's ways with whole societies, necessarily undermines any potential idolatry by placing a nation under the judgment of God. Quote, Christian theology should consider such a pledge to a national covenant to be of positive value because it renders the policies of a nation accountable to the will of God as expressed in the Bible and places the nation under the judgment of God if the nation makes itself accountable to the terms of God's covenant. Such accountability, Pottenberg suggested, enables those with spiritual eyes to see a whole range of types. One is the pattern of pervasive secularism and later judgment. Now, this is the biblical motif, he said, of God's withdrawal of his manifest presence from a society that has rejected him. Quote, when God seems absent not only from the world, but from the hearts of human beings, this does not indicate, as a superficial evaluation might suggest, that perhaps God died. No, it foretells impending judgment on a world that has alienated itself from its source of life. Close quote. Now, another biblical pattern that's a recurring type in history is war as divine judgment. For an earlier public theologian who believed in the national covenant and used it to find this historical type in American history, I turn to Abraham Lincoln, who referred to America as the almost chosen people and as the last best hope of earth. In terms not unlike Edwards's invocation of the national covenant, Lincoln proclaimed in an 1863 proclamation of a general fast the following. We have been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity. We have grown in numbers, wealth, and power as no other nation has ever grown. But we have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied, enriched, and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own. Intoxicated with unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to the God that made us. It behooves us then to humble ourselves before the offended power, capital P, to confess our national sins and to pray for clemency and forgiveness. That sounds like a graduate of Dallas Theological Seminary. like Edwards, Lincoln believed that God punishes a people corporately for its corporate sins. Lincoln applied this paradigm to the Civil War and concluded it was just such a punishment. Here's Lincoln again. "And insomuch as we know that by his divine law, nations like individuals are subjected to punishments and chastisements in this world," now there's the National Covenant, "may we not justly fear that the awful calamity of a civil war, which now desolates the land, may be but just such a punishment inflicted upon us for our presumptuous sins to the needful end of our national reformation as a whole people." 2 years later, in his oft-quoted second inaugural address, just before he was assassinated, Lincoln again referred to the Civil War as a judgment of God. "If God will that the Civil War continue until all the wealth piled by the bondsman's 250 years of unrequited toil shall be sunk, and until every drop of blood drawn with the lash shall be paid by another drawn with the sword, as was said 3,000 years ago, so still it must be said, the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether." In his Cambridge lectures, Butterfield identified some other discernible types in history. The first is what I would call mediation in judgment. God uses wicked nations to judge other wicked nations. He uses them as mediators. God used wicked nations such as the Philistines and the Assyrians and the Babylonians to judge sinful Israel repeatedly. Now, the lesson from that type is humility. Just as we would never call those nations righteous because they were God's servants in judgment, so too British and Americans should not have concluded after World War II that they were righteous because God used them to destroy the wickedness of Nazism and Japanese imperialism. Judgment is sometimes remedial. This is another historical type. The exile in Babylon seems to have cured Israel of overt idolatry. So not every judgment renders its object null and void. The fall of Rome released Europe for a new phase of human experience, which one might say brought a measure of good out of a corrupted empire. Germany's radical departure from Nazism after its destruction and surrender in 1945 did allow for a post-war boom that continues to this day. While there was no extensive turn to God in Germany, there was a genuine national humility lamenting its behavior in the preceding decade and before. But Germany's destruction might represent yet another historical type, that of the sins of the fathers being visited on the third and fourth and succeeding generations. Butterfield traces the genesis of Nazism to Frederick the Great's pursuit of militarism as a national ideal for 18th century Prussia, and Bismarck's unification of Germany into a powerful European state. But Butterfield says the day of judgment, of punishment, was postponed for several generations because both Frederick and Bismarck called a halt to a career of conquest precisely because they had a curious awareness of the importance of the moral element in history. In the latter stages of both of their lives, they sought to maintain the peace of Europe. Now, Hitler had no such goal, and he committed the greatest historical sin, thinking himself to be a god. On this sort of leader, who worships the work of his own hands and says that the strength of his own right arm gave him the victory, judgment in history, says Butterfield, falls heaviest. For such a man, by aping providence, blasphemes God and brings more tragedy on the world and on himself than the people who give half their lives to wine, women, and song. This is the most reliable type in history, that of the leader or people who in pride think they can displace God. But Germany's destruction was not inevitable. If the German people had regarded their disastrous defeat in 1918 and the ruinous reparations imposed by the Versailles Treaty as God's judgment, and sought to, and had they sought to discover what they had done to offend God, then good could have come from evil. Redemption could have emerged from judgment. This is another type, the type of redemption through repentance and faith that appeared in a limited and secular way after 1945 in Germany, and in Japan for that matter. Now, the most interesting historical types involve Israel in post-biblical history. The first is that of the remnant. The prophets and then Paul distinguish between larger Israel and remnant Israel. Only the two southern tribes survived invasion and exile. Empires have come and gone, and many of them have killed Jews and murdered Jews in the thousands and the millions. But while the Assyrian Empire and the Babylonian Empire, the Roman Empire and the Nazi Empire, Third Reich, tried to destroy Israel, all those empires were destroyed instead, and only Israel remains. A Jewish remnant has always survived, with its culture, its language, and its religion intact. Every remnant that emerged after successive incarnations of Amalekites that arose to exterminate them was a type, I would suggest, of the holy remnant that is to come, Jesus' little flock that will join Gentiles with a purified Israel in the new heaven and the new earth. Even more intriguing is the type of vicarious suffering. We all know that Isaiah's suffering servant is a man who will suffer for the sins of God's people. But Isaiah also speaks of all Israel as the servant. In chapter 40, verse 8, "You Israel, my servant." In chapter 45, verse 4, "My servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen." In 48:20, "The Lord has redeemed his servant Jacob." In 49:3, "You are my servant Israel, in whom I will be glorified." Butterfield proposed that this is a new kind of vicarious suffering. Israel suffers not because God is judging her at the hands of her persecutors, but because she's actually better than her persecutors and has a mission. She suffers as God's messenger in order to expiate the sins of the Gentiles. She took their guilt and punishment upon herself and accepted the consequences of their sins. Now that's Butterfield speaking. Now if this is true, and I'm not certain that it is, it need not conflict with traditional Christian Christology and soteriology. If Christ is the embodiment of his church, which the New Testament says he is, then he is also the embodiment of faithful Israel. And what faithful Israel suffers, Christ suffers, just as Paul identifies his own suffering with the Messiah's afflictions in that mysterious Colossians 1:24. And just as Jesus said that when the church was persecuted, so was he. Hence, it should be no surprise that while Christ's suffering in his passion was a fully sufficient sacrifice, the suffering of his ongoing body on earth, faithful Israel, both Gentile and Jew, is also his. That's why the risen Jesus told Paul that when he was persecuting the church, he was really persecuting Jesus. Therefore, if Jesus' suffering was vicarious for the sake of his body, all later vicarious suffering by his body points back to his suffering and participates in his, just as Paul said his suffering participated in the Messiah's afflictions by somehow making up what was lacking in them, Colossians 1:24. So if Paul's suffering somehow participates in the Messiah's sufferings, which expiates the sins of the Gentiles, and if the Messiah as suffering servant is the embodiment of faithful Israel as suffering servant, then perhaps there's a mysterious way in which faithful Israel's sufferings participate in the Messiah's redemption of the Gentiles. Martin Luther King Jr. did not believe, as far as I know, in an ontological connection between the suffering of his civil rights workers and the suffering of Jesus in his passion. But he did teach the power of vicarious suffering. When the editor of the Christian Century urged him in 1960 to describe his own sufferings, King wrote as follows. I have known very few quiet days in the last few years. I've been arrested 5 times, and in 1960 I was put in Alabama jails. My home has been bombed 2x. A day seldom passes, and my family and I are not the recipients of threats of death. I've been the victim of a near-fatal stabbing. So in a real sense, I've been battered by the storms of persecution. I must admit that at times I have felt that I could no longer bear such a heavy burden and have been tempted to retreat to a more quiet and serene life. King was reluctant to detail his own sufferings because he didn't want to develop a martyr complex or make others think he was seeking sympathy. But he said these trials taught him the value of unmerited suffering. They led him to think that suffering can bring transformation to himself and healing to the people involved in the tragic situation. I think by that he meant the people bringing him and his civil rights workers persecution and suffering. He became convinced that unearned suffering is redemptive. Now, those are his words. King was pointing to a profound historical type of vicarious suffering that benefits others, pointing back to and perhaps even ontologically connected to the antitype, Jesus' redemptive suffering in his life and death. The last historical type in Butterfield's masterful account is the most pervasive throughout history and perhaps the most powerful. The secret piety of the unnumbered billions of faithful Christians who lived lives of beautiful faith by virtue of their union with their Lord. This is a type because it can be seen in history, at least to those who come close to these living saints. And it points to its antitype, Jesus, the Jewish Messiah. The infinite varieties of faithful experience point in typological fashion to the infinite aspects of the Trinitarian God, the God of Israel. They are types in history pointing to and teaching about the living triune God. As Butterfield puts it, these were the lights that never went out throughout the millennia of God's church on earth. Through the darkest periods of heresy and schism, priests and ministers were preaching the gospel week in and week out, constantly reminding the farmer and the shopkeeper of love and humility, persuading them to think for a moment about the great issues of life and inducing them to confess their sins. In every age, the Lamb who takes away the sins of the world became known to millions, if not more. In this way, the church never failed to produce new historical types. How then are we to discern? How are we to know the difference between authentic types that God has placed in history and our imagined types that we ascribe naively to God? The question. First of all, we should always recall that just as the historical Jesus was often not recognized as Messiah when he was present in the flesh, so too today, his footprints in the world, and let's say for now that historical types are just that, usually go unrecognized. Not only are they hidden from the eyes of the natural man, as Paul insists in 1 Corinthians 1 and 2, but even the regenerate often miss them. Second, we should recognize that history is not only horizontal but also vertical. Because we distinguish Christian philosophy of history, which focuses on the linear, from ancient and Eastern philosophies that tend toward the cyclical and the circular, we can become too focused on the telos. We imbibe the nominalist fallacy that history is simply a linear temporal continuum without ongoing participation in God's active providence. This is not only a metaphysical mistake, but a failure to apply biblical theology to our philosophy of history. After all, Scripture says we can share Messiah's suffering, 1 Peter 4, so that we can now partake in the glory that is to be revealed, that's 1 Peter 5, and now become partakers of the divine nature, that's 2 Peter 1. Now, another way of putting this is to see with Butterfield that every generation is equidistant from eternity. Every instant is eschatological. In that sense, the purpose of life is not the future, but the present, to participate in eternal life now. And one way of doing that is to see that the types all around us in nature and history, especially to see them in history as present. History then is not so much a train traveling toward a destination, although of course in one sense it is, but it's more like a symphony whose every part is to be enjoyed, not just the ending of the symphony. The architecture of the whole work, as Butterfield put it, can be experienced in every part of the work, or in our case, in every moment of history. For yet another analogy, think of the Chesapeake Bay Bridge Tunnel. How many of you traveled through that? Okay. This amazing feat of energy goes on for 23 miles, and so do you as you're traveling on it. Once on it, you cannot stop without getting hit from behind and thus withdrawing permanently from linear history. There are no exits or off ramps until the end. That's how many Christians think of history. It will have no final meaning or clarity until its end. And types are man-made and therefore unreliable at best, idolatrous at worst. But imagine, if you can, the old Route 66 that was finished in 1926 and carried travelers for 2,400 miles from Chicago to California. Now, did any of you have any of you ever traveled on the old Route 66? Okay. Drivers could stop almost wherever they wanted, just pull to the side of the road, right? And enjoy the land or scenery, and they did. I'm older than I look. This is like history as we should imagine it, not merely linear, but also participatory history. It stops at every point to look up and around into eternity. Types are real, and they're all along the way. But to get back to the question, how do we discern the true types? And this is what I'm going to close on. Two final rules. The first is the rule of written revelation. The types need to be suggested or authorized by God's written revelation in Scripture, just as God, through words, showed Moses his ways. Once again, Psalm 103, verse 7. In my previous lectures, I've elaborated a bit on what that means. Second, it's always safer to recognize judgment on our own ideas and works than on others. And if we do venture the latter, we should beware of unwitting self-righteousness. For example, if we say that the looming defeat of ISIS is a type of God's judgment of pride and blasphemy pointing to the final judgment, which I believe it is, we must not presume that we are inherently better than members of ISIS. There's no doubt that the Christian faith, now, which is distinct from my apprehension of that faith, is infinitely superior to that of Islam. But my appropriation of that faith was a gift of God to this poor sinner. Right now, my ideas are hopefully better than those of the ISIS fighter. And thankfully, my inner character has been shaped to a degree by a Jewish stonemason from the first century who still lives. But I am what I am by the grace of God. And when I think of that ISIS soldier, I must remind myself that there but for the grace of God go I. Thank you. So, we have lots of time, at least a minute, for a question. Yes, sir.
I have a question about, as was going through my mind as you were talking, with the invention of telecommunications, the internet, we have every single day laid at our feet the cares and concerns of the world. And on an individual level, that's a lot to handle. And I think that when we see these images flash before us of wars and famine and poverty, I think there could be two reactions to it. One is to go out and try and fix every problem all at once. But do you think it is more effective as we are trying to help our nation to deal with things on our local levels and the people that God brings into our lives if he's orchestrating our lives in history? So individual or social reform, political, big scale, which do you think is more effective?
It depends on what God's calling you to. God calls some to local, God calls some to national, God calls some to international. God wants his church to be everywhere. well, I suppose we're over time, but one last question here. Our friend, the engineer.
Oh, and I beat Dan, so I'm thankful for that. So I just wanted to know, in thinking about, or in listening to this, I was thinking about how, so if you've classified, or you thought about a nation, or where it stood, or where it is in history, how it's developed, and you've sort of have a type in your mind, or you're using typology, how predictive is it? I mean, how much...
How predictive?
How prescriptive is it where it's going to tomorrow, or how predictive is it, I guess?
How prescriptive or how predictive?
A little bit of both, yeah.
Well, you know, as I said early on in this talk, we know what the end is. I mean, Jesus is going to win. And, you know, hopefully you're on his side, you're on the winning side. But we don't know how many innings are going to be played before the end of the game, and they might be some really painful innings. And we might be thrown out of the game, you know, frankly. More and more Christians are getting killed around the world. So, and because of the contingencies of history, human beings are free. Now, God controls all the freedom of human beings, but human beings are free under God's sovereignty. We can't predict. There's no way we... Now, there are certain patterns, and these are the types that I tried to identify here. But for instance, you know, Jonah came to Nineveh, and Jonah predicted immediate judgment, but because of repentance, the judgment was postponed for some decades at least. So because we cannot predict how free human beings will respond to God's word, only God knows. But we should try to discern the times and discern what God is saying, as Niebuhr said. Thank you.